Latency versus data rate. Many have tried to tackle this topic, but most have only just skimmed the surface of the issue. I've been lurking around the Extreme Overclocking Discord for quite a bit, and a lot of people over there want to beat their chest when it comes to talking about their impressive data rates or blazing fast latency timing. But for the average PC gamer, the larger question remains, what is more important? Data rate or latency. But in today's video, I'm making a complete comparison of the two factors while also considering price and performance. Let's set the stage. You've picked your processor, your motherboard, and your graphics card for your next build. Looking at your budget, you start to see that there's just not a lot of money left to go around. So, what type of memory should you pick up? Should you get that shiny RGB kit that runs at an impressive 4000 data rate? Or do you heed the advice of many experts on the internet that say, go with the lowest cast latency possible? Both have their merits, and many have found that yes, either selection would perform better. But let's take a step back. How do each of these values impact your gameplay when combined? Will a 3200 CL14 kit perform better than a 3600 CL18 kit? And of course, depending on your budget and availability, this dilemma comes up with many combinations. Today, I'm doing what we call in the industry a schmoo, or more clearly explained, a multivariable search. I'll be looking at data rate and latency as I walk through each of the many popular DDR4 kit combinations on the market. That's 29 different kits that I'm going to be testing. I'm evaluating all the way from 2400 CL15 up to 4000 CL18. As you might have guessed, I don't have $4,500 to test each of these different kits, so I'm going to be repurposing my go-to kit for my CPU test bench, my Corsair Dominator Platinums. This kit sports some Samsung B-Die and is binned at 3466 CL16. Though it's not an overly impressive kit, it manages to effectively hit all of the combinations in most of the tests today. I'll be running 4 sticks of 8GB apiece and dual rank operation. As for timings, I'll be matching TCL, TRCD, and TRP. For TRAS, I'm using this formula in order to get as close to the retail timings as I can. Lastly, I'm using my old 10700K in the ASRock Z590 PG Velocita motherboard for my testing. I wanted to start with older Intel parts because they are known for their reliability with their memory overclocks. And I also wanted to prove that what I'm actually changing makes a difference. To isolate the memory performance as much as possible, I'm going to be overclocking the processor to a 5GHz all-core overclock. Intel's Turbo Boost is good, but not reliable enough for our testing today. Also, I'm running all of my fans on the CPU and GPU at 100% to minimize any thermal throttling chance. I noticed several instances in my standard config where FPS decreased from run to run, which admittedly caused me to bang my head against my desk. As for games, I've got 5 that hit the CPU, GPU, and a balanced approach of games included are Gears 5, Assassin's Creed Valhalla, Metro Exodus, Rainbow Six Siege, and Hitman 3. I'll be using the built-in benchmarking tools because, guys, I've got over 24 hours of testing I need to do, so I need a streamlined and repeatable test, which I'll talk about throughout the video. Let's go. Now let's set a baseline with some synthetics to see how each of the different memory configurations stack up. IDA 64 has a decent overall memory benchmark that reports latency and bandwidth. When looking at these charts, dark red values are rated as being the slower end of the spectrum, and dark green values show ratings that are on the faster end of the spectrum. As I increase the data rate and decrease the cast latency of the DIMM, overall latency results decrease. The inverse is true as well. Slower data rates cycle less often and thus increase the overall latency. Moving into the bandwidth measurements, what's surprising here is that memory latency has negligible impact on the overall bandwidth. Here and in future charts, the dark green results are faster while the dark red are slower. As expected, increasing the data rate increases the bandwidth. Shocking, I know, right? Overall, going from 2400 to 4000 on the data rate, I see nearly a 60% improvement in overall memory bandwidth. Now that we've built the foundation, let's see how memory performs with different types of games. Hitman 3 is the latest addition in the Hitman catalog, which is known as a CPU-limited game. For testing, I'm running the built-in test in a loop, and I'm manually triggering measurements on the average and 1% lows, since the tool doesn't have any of those fancy computer-readable outputs. With 3 samples per data point, a similar trend is observed as IDA64, where generally faster rates with less latency perform better than slower rates with more latency. Looking at CL16 as an example, I see a 38 FPS increase in average frame rates going from 2400 to 3800. That translates into a 22% improvement. Latency only sees a relative performance improvement ranging between 2 and 8.8 FPS across the different kits. Looking at 1% lows, I also see those increase with a 36 FPS improvement at CL16. So Hitman 3 responds very well with varying memory configurations. Now, let's talk about those bordered squares. I've highlighted varying configurations with equal values of system latency as reported by IDA64. For example, the solid black border configurations at 3400 in CL16 have the same latency as 3800 at CL18. For Hitman 3, I see about a 5 FPS improvement when favoring bandwidth instead of latency for each of the matching kits. Rainbow Six Siege hits some massive frame rates with my current test bench, so I'm hoping that this translates into more resolution in our data. Again, similar trends as Hitman 3, though I do see impressive frame rate increases with the data rate. I see a 58 FPS increase at CL16 for a 16% improvement, though only between 5 and 22 FPS with the latency increase. Unfortunately, the 3600 CL14 test point didn't run, suggesting that this application can be pretty stressful on the memory subsystem. As for 1% lows, similar improvements are seen across the board. With all things considered, this could be an excellent example of just how tuning your system's memory settings can get you past the 120 or 240 Hz breakpoints for your gameplay. Assassin's Creed Valhalla, however, hit the brakes, wants to change the stakes a bit. Across the data rates, I only observe a 3 FPS improvement across the board. Improving the memory latency shows to have minimal impact on the overall frame rate in this game. Comparing the different memory kits with the same overall system latency is a prime example that either kit will perform just as good as the other. Gears 5 has proven to be a challenging game to test. As shown in my game analysis video, the benchmark tool shows some sensitivity to the data rate, so I'm interested in seeing how it reacts to tweaking the latency. Unfortunately, the game does have a built-in variance in its results, so I have to run 5 different samples in order to get an accurate result for each test run. With lower average frame rates than Hitman 3, I see expected scaling in frame rate improvement as I increase the data rate. Also, I see expected scaled improvement as I decrease the memory latency. However, when looking at the percentage points in our overall performance here, it isn't all that great. I see an 11.5% gain with average frame rates, while it improves by only 9.5% on the 1% low frame rates. However, unlike the other games we've tested today, as I improve the memory performance, I see the average versus 1% low deltas increase by nearly 10 FPS, which isn't ideal. Keeping 1% lows as close to the average frame rate is preferable, since we'll see less variability in our overall action. Finishing us off today is Metro Exodus, which sees less dependency on latency, but leans more on the data rate. The improvement, it's not dramatic, but it could bump players up to 144 Hz instead of 120, based on your GPU, of course. And as with Gears 5, Metro's minimum frame rate delta increases by 10 FPS. Again, showing evidence that improved latency, it doesn't always translate into better minimum frame rates. On the bright side though, with Metro Exodus, I do see marginally better performance improvements overall. Now let's roll this all up. Looking at the geo mean of the 5 games across the different DIMM configurations, I see between 11 and 29 FPS improvement across the different data rates, with between 1 and 9 FPS improvements with the different cast latencies. Translated, across the various kits, I get about a 19% improvement in frame rate between the slowest kit, that's 2400 CL17, and the fastest kit, 3600 CL16. Going back to the kit-to-kit comparison, it reinforces our earlier finding that the faster data rate kit will provide the higher FPS regardless of the overall system latency. However, it's in the margin of 2 to 5 FPS, so in real-world scenarios, you might not even tell the difference. Putting the system into standard boosting conditions and hitting some of those GPU thermal thresholds, expect all of these results to tighten up significantly. But back to the original question, which kits should you get? The general recommendation is to get the fastest data rate your platform can support with the best timings that you can afford. But let's take a closer look here. The memory market is very broad and the different vendors and sales can vary from week to week. I took a snapshot from Newegg of Corsair, G-Skill, and the absolute minimum cost to match this 32 gigabyte setup that I have today. Let's start with G-Skill. I primarily lean towards their Ripjaw series when it comes to value, but if you're looking for some RGB, expect to pay a premium of $8 or more per stick. The Ripjaw series tends to stack the low to mid-range bandwidths, and it does cover most of the timings pretty well. But the Trident Z lineup focuses more on the faster, quicker kits. For price to performance, 3600 at CL18 seems to be a sweet spot, only sacrificing between 1 to 5 FPS for some of the more responsive kits. Some other good choices are DDR4 3000 or 3200 at CL16. They only lose between 9 to 4 FPS, respectively. Corsair's lineup is a bit more expensive, with their base LPX lineup costing just about the same as the Trident Z. Their kits are also more centered towards CL16, so not as much variety in this selection. Again, DDR4, 3600, CL18 with their LPX kit seems to be a great option when balancing latency and bandwidth. It would also appear that their CL16 RGB options come in a bit cheaper than the similar Trident Z kit. Now, let's go straight up with the cheapest kits for each of the different timings today. Man, looking at all these prices, it definitely feels like the Wild West, but there is a clear trend on what kind of kits are of value. If you're wanting an inexpensive CL14 high-speed kit, Corsair's LPX is a great option, though similarly performing kits can be found at higher data rates and looser timings, and at a fraction of the cost. Looking at you, 4000 CL18. As for kits with the same system latency, it's actually cheaper within the price to performance range to get the slower data rate with the faster timings in most cases. You do sacrifice a bit of performance between 2 and 5 FPS with the slower kit, but you do end up saving quite a bit of cash. Between 3800 CL18 and 3400 CL16, that you save about $50. And if you're looking for 32 gigabytes on a budget, 2400 CL15 can save $32 compared to the 2666 CL18. Taking the slowest kit versus the fastest kit into consideration, you can save about $226 and only lag by 33 FPS on average. Usually, this kind of saving is trivial, but $200, it can easily bump you up a tier with your CPU or bump you up to the next GPU class. Now, I'm not advocating you go and buy 2400 CL17 by any means, but this sort of info can definitely help you optimize your budget. Of course, these results are for my particular test setup today, so if you're going to go with a 16 gigabyte capacity, you might see less differences, especially with the price to performance. Also, there's the performance impacts when going from a dual rank configuration like we tested to a single rank. So keep that in mind if you're going to be only getting 2 sticks of RAM. Also, I am very interested to see how AMD's parts stack up in this comparison. If that's something that you guys want to see, make sure you hit that like button. With all this said, guys, I am thrilled I actually collected the data so that you guys can pick a good kit of RAM for your next build or upgrade. Should I go higher with a 4400 megahertz RAM kit or look at the newer Intel parts? I always respond to the comments, so let me know down below, and we always love to have in-depth conversations over at the Turk Force Discord. With all that said, guys, thank you all for watching the video. I hope to see you in the next one. Take care, guys.